Welcome everyone to this webinar on quantum mechanics for an introduction to quantum mechanics. And I'm going to start sharing my screen shortly, but just a few words about myself. So my name is Maria Alfredsson and I'm a lecturer in the School of Physical Sciences at the University of Kent, and I am a chemist by training, and I did normal undergraduate chemistry. But then when I started doing postgraduate studies, I got really interested in quantum mechanics and theoretical calculations. So that is what I did for many years. The last years I have been doing a bit of mix of both experiments and computational chemistry to predict how materials for battery work. And so what I wanted to do today was to give a little bit of an introduction to quantum mechanics. And I'm going to start sharing my screen with you so that we can, here. So now you should be able to, I'm still not sharing my screen. Why did it not? I am sharing my screen. Can you see it, Stefania?
Yeah, I can see.
Yeah, perfect. So the lecture I'm going to introduce is part of a stage two course that is quantum mechanics and spectroscopy. And it has a code CH532. The lecture is not exactly what we are teaching in the lecture because I have left out some proofs and I'm not going to go over the maps so much in detail today, but it's a little bit an idea on what we can do with quantum mechanics and actually apply it and why it is so important in our daily life. So first of all, if we are starting a lecture at the University of Kent in chemistry, I would give you my contact details and I have given them to you here as well. So if you have any questions after the lectures, you can just send me an email or you can phone me because I am in the lab most of the days. But you would also have the possibility to contact me via Teams as it is now in my office hours. And before we used to have them face-to-face, of course, but nowadays we are doing them on Teams. So the lecture is going to cover just some basic definitions of an introduction to what is called a particle in the box and the theory behind particle in the box. What we mean with quantized energy levels and zero energy, and then we are going to go into how we can apply this theory, looking at colors and predicting colors. And then in the end of the lecture, we're actually going to do some quantum mechanical calculations ourselves. So the reading I expect you to have done before this lecture, if you were in class, would have been to study Atkins Physical Chemistry, topic 7D, which is called Translational Motion, and it's page 262 to 266. What you can do if you want after the lecture is to go in and have a look at something called LibreText, and it is web-based books that are free to read. And especially the first one here called Particle in the Box, the one-dimensional box, I think is a really good reading if you have for A-level students to get into quantum mechanics and the particle in the box. If you want a little bit of more of maps, there is the second link as well, Particle in a Box. Both of them are on chemistry LibreText. And you might find some interesting other reading there that you want to see. If we start by looking at a molecule will have a kinetic energy. And we know that kinetic energy is defined by the mass of the particle and the speed of the particle squared divided by 2. We also know that this kinetic energy depends on the temperature, and it can take any value you want. So if you have a low temperature, you have a rather small distribution, but it's still, it can take energy, any energy within this distribution. As you increase the temperature, the molecules are starting to move faster, and you can see this here in this slide where they increase the temperature with the bar, and they are moving faster. And then as the temperature is increased even more, it can take even more kinetic energies. And now at really high temperature, you have a very broad distribution of kinetic energies. But those energies can take any value. And that is important for molecules. The kinetic energy can take any value. What about if we go to an electron? So we have to think a little bit differently. So if we have an electron and we put it in a box, the first thing we have to do is to create this box. So we draw a box. And then Schrödinger and his colleagues, they found in the beginning of the 1900 that these particles, the electrons, they take specific discrete energy values. They can no longer take any energy they want. They have specific energy values, so discrete energy values. Also, the energy cannot be zero. And they found that the energy differences between these energy levels, or the energy values that you could take, depends on where you are in the box. So at low energies, which is in the bottom of the box, and then as we increase the energy, these energy differences are increasing. So the difference between the energy levels are increasing according to this theory that was initially proposed. And it was also proposed that we can calculate mathematically the energy of these individual energy levels. As I said, this was derived in the beginning of the 1900. And what came up was this model of the particle in the box. And what I'm going to be now is be quiet, and I ask you to read and follow this video a little bit. So look, we have shrunk the box from 1 meter to 10 in the power of minus 6. It's very small. It's the atomic scale now. And start looking at the particle. It start to behave like a wave. It did not behave like that before. Before it was just going forward and back. And depending on the energy or where we are in these energy levels that we introduced, the wave will have different shapes. So that was found by I'm just going to move this one so we can actually see the window. So what we found, what was found by this early quantum mechanics or these theories, was that an electron doesn't only behave as a particle, but it also have this wave function, behaves as a wave. And that is what is the dual properties of an electron or a quantum particle. And it was also found that they obey an equation that was described by Schrödinger. So therefore it is described as Schrödinger's equation. And it depends on this energy, but it also depends on this function here, which is called psi. And in this case, it depends on x, which is the one-dimensional box. And the psi is our wave function. And Schrödinger showed that psi function can be described by a sinus function and a cos function, where A and B are constants. And further, it was shown that this term K has a specific value that depends on the mass of the particle and the energy and the constant called Planck's constant, a bar constant. And we come back to that constant later on. So let us now then describe this this box and what is the implication of it. We don't have to understand the maps at this point, but just understand what the box is actually doing and what the particle is doing and why we have this quantitized energy levels. So we start by creating our box. And the thing we do is that we impose something called boundary conditions. We say that the walls of this boundary, I'm just going to change my laser now, this walls has an infinite height. That means that the particle must be inside the box because the walls are so high that it cannot escape outside. So we put a barrier on the outside of the box. That means that the particle must be inside. And that means that in the walls, this psi and cos function, that wave function that we derived before, must be zero if we are at the wall. And that is when x is zero and what we are at this other end of the box, which is L, the length of the box. And that is true if sinus zero, because x is zero, that is zero, that is coming back to our maps. And then it's also true, but it's not true for the cos function, because if we go to x equals zero, the cos function is one. So that means that this constant B must be zero. Or that means that we have simplified our wave function to be only a sinus function, and that is really helpful. And then we replace our K value with the constant we had before, and then we can solve for E. And I'm not going to do that in this lecture here, but if we do that, we get this equation that I derived before. So what does it mean? I have L, which is the length of my box, M, which is the mass of the electron or the particle, the same as we had for the classical particle. But I have an integer here, N, 1, 2, 3. And what is that? That N is actually the number of the energy levels. It's a quantum number, it's called. And that N is 1. We can calculate the energy for energy level 1. If n is 2, we can calculate the energy level for 2, and so on. And what you see is there is no zero. That means that we have no, the energy cannot be possible with zero. So we have a zero point energy, which means that there's an electron always have some kinetic energy. That's really important. Even at zero Kelvin, then electron has a kinetic energy. That was the energy. What about the wave function then? The wave function we said was given by this sinus function, which also depends on this quantum number n. And we put that one in, we get n equals 1, 2, 3, and so on. And if we look at it, these wave functions will look differently for n equals 1, 2, and so for 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and so on. So the wave function will look differently. And what I want you to do now is that you are going to try to predict how the wave function for n equals 3 and n equals 4 look like. And we start by looking at the n equals 1. If you can see, it is it has no crossing of this blue line. So it has the same, the way we say that the wave function has the same sign all the time. If we look at the blue one, it is above and below. So it's positive and it's negative. And that means that when we cross, when the wave functions change sign, we have a node. And you can see for n equals one, there is no node, zero nodes. For n equals two, we have one node. So how many nodes do you think n3 and n4 has? Let me go out and go in, and I'm going to open. I have created something called a form here. And I see if you want, and if you have access to a computer, you can try to answer a form as part of this lecture. I'm just going to see where I find my Zoom. Yep, no. So now I have lost my chat here. I am sorry, I seem to have lost my...
Dr. Alfredsson, if you just go back on...
I found it. Yeah, I found it. I'm sorry, I should have... I know where it... No. No, I'm sorry, where is the chat? Here it is, sorry, I have it here. There it is, sorry everyone. We're using Teams for teaching and I have forgotten how to use Zoom. I haven't used it for some time, I apologize. So let's go back to this, the form, and see if you, any one of you can answer that one. I should have opened it so that it's available to everyone. Let's see if any one of you can answer it. So how many nodes would n equals 3 have, and how many nodes would n equals 4 have? You should be able to click on the link that I put in the chat, and then you should reach this web page. Oh, excellent. Yes, brilliant. Yeah, that's right. So if we go in and if we have a look, what we find is that n equals 3 has two nodes. 1, 2, 4 has 1, 2, 3 nodes. So the number of nodes are one less the quantum number. So that was something that can be useful to remember. But what the key point of this first part of the lecture was that you should know what is a quantized particle or energy levels and what is zero point energy. And that a quantum particle has both particle and wave properties. And you should know what the quantum number is and that it's increasing as the nodes are increasing in, that the nodes are increasing with the quantum number. Because that means, if we go back and have a quick look at this picture, it means that the wave number or the wave is increasing. So the wavelengths are getting shorter, so it has more energy. So higher energy gets higher wave number. So how can we apply this one then to look at the colors? So the second part of this is how to apply the particle in the box to predict colors. And the first thing we have to do is to introduce something called the highest occupied energy level, or lowest unoccupied energy levels. In chemistry, and I don't know if you have worked with molecular orbitals yet, we would normally refer to these energy levels as highest occupied molecular orbital, HOMO, and lowest unoccupied molecular orbital called LUMO. But it's the highest energy level that has electrons in it, and the lowest unoccupied energy level is the energy level that the first one that is unoccupied, doesn't have any electrons in it. And then we can have to be able to count conjugated bonds and how we can define and relate energy to a wavelength using the definition of a photon. And then we look at complementary colors. And if you just remember, that is that the visible spectrum, so colors, have wavelengths from 400 to about 800. If we have lower, so higher wave numbers, which means lower energies, it's above 800. And if it has very short wavelengths, as we saw from the particle in the box, the shorter wavelength, the higher energy, we are in the UV-VIS part of the spectra. So I'm going to introduce ethene to you, because I don't know if you have been working with conjugated bonds yet. So this is, but I do believe you have. So this is just a reminder. If I have ethene, each of that carbon here will have the carbon and have an interaction, which is a double bond. Each of those carbons has one electron in its pi electrons. So each electron, each carbon has one electron, so that means we have two electrons. If I was going to put those two electrons, I would have one carbon bond, so I would be in the lowest quantum number, n equals one. That means that these two electrons would be in my highest molecular occupied, highest occupied molecular orbital, or the highest occupied energy level, that is my HOMO. And what I can do is that I can excite one of these electrons from my HOMO to my LUMO. That is called my excitation energy. And the energy difference between the HOMO and the LUMO is given by this equation here, which I have derived from this E, the energy that I specified for this individual energy level. So I've taken the difference of the one with n equals one and the n equals two, and I have derived this equation. And as part of the post-lecture exercise is to actually show that this equation is correct. So what does it mean that I excite an electron from HOMO to LUMO? If I would take beta carotene is a longer conjugated chain, longer than the ethene that we saw before. And we know that carots are orange. And the color of this carotene depends on the length this conjugated chain. I use that as my box. So that is the L in my box. So I can then identify the length of beta carotene. So now I have a length of the box. Can I now calculate this energy from this equation? Let's see if we can do that. First of all, we need to calculate how many conjugated bonds we have. Because we have 22 carbons in this conjugated bond, we have 22 electrons. Just like for ethene, we had two because we had two carbons that was double bonded. If you remember what we did here, we always put two electrons in each energy level. So I do the same here. If I put two energies in each energy level, I can only have max two electrons in each energy level. I have 11 energy levels occupied. So my HOMO will be N equals 11 and my LUMO would be N equals 12. So then I have my N, which is my 11, because that corresponds to the highest occupied energy level. And I can now look up what this H is, and that is called Planck's constant, and I'm sure you have heard about it. It's 6.626 in the power of minus 34 joules per second, and the units are important. Always remember your units. I can now calculate the length of this chain if I know the length of single bonds and double bonds. And if I calculate the bonds lengths of this, or the length of this chain, it's about 30 in the power of minus 10 meters. So 30 angstrom long. And then I have the M, which is the mass of the electron. And if I put in these numbers, I get a value that is 1.51 in the power of minus 19 joules. So I have the numbers and I put them in. That should have been a one. I do apologize. It's 1.51 in the power of minus 19 joules. I check my units. Planck's constant is joules per second. And then I have lambda c, which is the speed of light, which is in meter per second. My joules and joules are cancelling out. My second and second are cancelling out. So what I get is that I have a wavelength and it's given in meters. So now I have a wavelength, a number that is 3.06 in the power of minus 6 meters, which is 1.306 nanometers. So beta carotene absorb light with the wavelength of 1,306 nanometers. So I excite an electron when I absorb the energy. So what I'm doing is that I have my HOMO and I excite it to the LUMO, like it was coming up in this little cartoon before. Sorry. So the message to take away is that I have a conjugated polymer, which allow me to calculate the length of a box. We have two equations that I expect you to remember and to use. And that means that I can calculate and derive a wavelength from the energy, which depends on this energy difference between the HOMO and LUMO. So what does it mean? So what is the color of carrot then? So I have my HOMO, and by applying a shining light on it, what is going to happen when I shine light on it, all the different colors are going to hit my sample, and I excite one electron from the LUMO, HOMO to the LUMO. And when I do that, I will absorb one wavelength. That wavelength, if it is the blue one, it will not come out of the spectra anymore. We will not see it. And it's the blue color that is absorbed. That means that what we are going to see is the complementary color of the carrot. So it is an orange color. That is what we expect, at least. But if we take this wavelength that we calculated, 1,360, it's here. It's in the IR region. So actually, the carotene we have calculated, we would see as UV-VIS, which means we wouldn't see it. Actually, the carrot would be out sunbathing. So it's not exactly correct using the particle in the box, but it is not completely incorrect either. We are in the right region using this approximation, and that is a good thing. So what we can do to prove that it is blue is that we can put our experiment, our carotene, in a UV-VIS, which is a piece of equipment. We see which of these colors that is absorbed. And if I follow carotene, which is this orange line, I will see that I have a peak at about 497 nanometer. And that corresponds to the blue light. And that blue, that means that the blue light is absorbed, and I will see carrots as orange. And that is because what we will see is the complementary color. So if we absorb blue, we see the complementary color, which is orange. So the last part of the lecture, what I wanted to do was to see if you could try to do some calculations yourself to see if we can correct this number 1360 by using some quantum mechanical calculations. And if you can't do it now because you might not have access to a computer, what I wanted to do was to we can open this program, which is available online, and you can use it as you want. And this program is called WebMo. It's called WebMo. And if you open it, there is a button called Demo. And if I click on Demo, I get up a login to a demo server. And what I'm going to do now is that I'm actually going to do this having the instructions up as well. So I give you a few minutes to try to do this on your own with the instructions open, and then I'm going, I can give you a few minutes to see if you can find the WebMo. It's www.webmo.net. And then go to demo. And then what we do when we have it up, we log in as a guest. And you can try this at home later on if you can't do it now, because there is, we're going to give the link to the lecture so you can follow it later on and try. It's fun. You can have fun with this. So I log in and I get this web page, which contains a lot of examples that has been done, but I want to do a new job. So I will go to create a new job. And what I could do is to draw the molecule, but carotene was quite long. So instead I go to lookup and I say import by name, and I type beta carotene. And it's important that you use the beta, otherwise it will not find it. So it's not enough to just try carotene. You have to really type in beta carotene. And then you get the molecule that we had up before. So this would be the molecule that you had before. You can move it around, you can look at it. And you can see it's looking, it's have its hydrogens, and it has its chain of polymers, conjugated polymers. And so that is how it looks. You can, and you can draw your own molecules, and you can do these calculations for the molecules you are drawing yourself. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to go to calculate, and I'm going to choose Hickel, which is a something called a semi-empirical calculation, which was derived to work with conjugated polymers. We click molecular orbitals. And what I got was a list of numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. These numbers correspond to your quantum numbers. And now it doesn't only consider the conjugated carbons that we had before, so there is more than 11 complete energy levels. But instead, actually, you see there is 2 electrons in each energy level. Now we go up and we get to 50, there are still 2 electrons in them. 75, there are still 2 electrons in all the energy, so they're still occupied. 100, they're still occupied. But here they're saying 0. So if we look, 108 has 2 electrons in it. It's an occupied energy level. Its next one is 109. It has 0 electrons in it. So the 108 is one is our HOMO, and 109 is our LUMO. And we now can get this energy here, the energy difference between the HOMO and the LUMO. We don't have to calculate it using the particle in the box. We just calculate the difference between those 2 energy levels. And I go back. And I calculate the wavelength using this instead. And what I need to do first is that, if you remember before, we said that Planck's constant was in joules per second. So I need to convert EV, which was the unit I got in WebMo, to joules. So I do that calculation, and the conversion factor is 1.6 in the power of minus 19. And if I type in the numbers, I get a wavelength of 1,637 nanometers. So unfortunately, this Sickle method was not working that much better. So what can we then do? So you are going to do a lab on this, and we do a lab which is based on dice, and we use it to predict the colors of these dice. And that can be done by using UV-VIS. This is how a UV-VIS looks like. We take dice that has different colors and we examine them in the UV-VIS, and we get this absorption spectra that you saw before. And from that UV-VIS, we get the wavelength, and from the wavelength, we can calculate the energy, and from the energy, we can calculate the length of the box. So we can calculate the length of the conjugated chains in these individual dyes. And then we can put that one into the particle in the box and predict the energy levels, the energy differences between the HOMO and the LUMO. If we know this, we can also calculate bond lengths and so on, and we can also predict colors of other dyes, because it gives us an idea on what we're going to do. So that is what we are doing in the lab. So the key concept of the last part of the lab is that you should know that if we absorb a wavelength, we see the complementary colors. You should be able to use a particle in the box to calculate colors and predict colors. And then you should be able to use WebMo to calculate energy difference using the Hickel method. So finally, a summary of the lecture. It was to define the particle in the box, see how we could apply it by predicting colors. And then we gave some practical examples on calculating the color of carrots. Unfortunately, it didn't come out orange, but it came in the right order. It was in the correct range. And that is a very important message to take away when we are looking at quantum mechanical calculations. We might not be exactly what the experiment is giving, but we are in the right order. And that is sometimes very important because it's allowing us to develop and predict trends. And that can sometimes be the more very important. And another application I didn't discuss, that quantum particles, they are in the nanometer range. So actually we can use the particle in the box, because here we know the length of the bond of the box, to predict colors of nanoparticles. So if you took silver particles, for example, or gold particles, they are not gold colored, they are pink. That is because they are colloids or nanoparticles. So that was the end of this lecture. And I think that now Stefania and I are going to ask questions, if you have any questions, either by the university or by the lecture itself. So please, we are really happy to answer questions now. I will take away and stop sharing my screen. Do we have any questions? Even in the chat, that is also fine. If you don't want to ask them, we can always ask them in the chat. So is there any one of you that has been in this, followed this series before? Have you been here before and asked questions? Just say yes or no in the chat. Or is it the first time? I don't know, maybe, yeah, you should be able to put questions in the chat. Have you all been here before? So I asked Stefania a little bit then. So you are in year three now. Tell us a little bit about your project, because that is related to this lecture, isn't it? You're muted, Stefania. You're muted.
Oh, sorry. I was talking this whole time. My project. Does relate to this lecture a little bit. So what my project actually consists of, we are looking at theta potentials. What they essentially are a computational way of modeling the bonds between atoms. And I'm testing them, since no one done that before. I'm just testing to see how the performance, if it's good, if it's bad, against other potentials that I found in articles. And yeah, and that's due metal oxide. That's my third year project for the moment.
Yeah, so you are doing the modeling to predict materials properties, aren't you? Yes. Yeah. So it is a very useful technique. I can say that for my PhD, I did a lot of calculations on hydrogen cyanide. And nice. I can tell you that was not something we really wanted to do experiment on, because nowadays, if we want to do experiment on hydrogen cyanide, we have to wear complete face mask. So doing it on a calculation on a computer is much safer. So that is one application of computational modeling. I also worked doing high pressure calculation on the deep Earth and on planets in the space, in universe. And the best thing of doing calculations on deep Earth, so the core in the Earth and the core mantle boundary in the Earth, is that no one can prove us wrong for the moment. So the calculations can show whatever they want, and no one can really prove us wrong. So that was a really good advantage.
Yeah.
We also did a lot of calculations on the Jovian moons. They are not so easy to go and travel to. So the spacecrafts have been around orbiting, but it's costing a lot of money, so easier to do calculations. So there's a lot of definitely fun things doing with computational chemistry. Any questions about how it is to be a student at the University of Kent? How has life been this year, Stefania? Has it been strange, or are you getting used to online lectures?
I'm getting used to it now. At first, I wasn't. Yeah, it took a while adjusting, but I've got the hang of it now. It's all right. Like, the standard of lectures still kept. They're all live, so you actually do have the possibility to ask questions right there and then, and the lecturer replies straight away. Of course, everyone is shy. No one really talks, but the lecturer did find a way to get everyone engaged. We actually do use a software, I guess I can call it, called Ambia, where it's anonymous and the lecturer will ask you questions and you can just go there and just answer it. And I think that is very good because, you know, anxiety when you're at home, you don't really want to just put something there and then everyone is listening and saying that you're wrong. So yeah, that really does as well keep engaged in the lecture. It's a shame not seeing your friends, a shame not to be on campus, of course. There's so many like good facilities that you can be in, but it's okay. Hopefully we'll get out of this soon.
And you do know that if you are in foundation year or stage one and stage two, you still have labs, so it's face to face.
You do actually have labs. I haven't had any yet, but normally you do have about once or twice labs a week, depending on the modules that you have during the term. Not all of them are lengthy, but you will spend quite amount of time in the lab. It can be fun, it can be dangerous, of course. Just have to respect the rules, listen when they talk, but other than that, it's great fun doing the experiments, seeing what you actually learn from the lectures and how you can put them all together and just come to actually see what they're talking about and really understand what is going on. Of course, every lab the week after, you do have to write a lab report. They get a bit annoying, I won't lie, but it's a great way to really just seal what you just learned, to really just look over what you did and just get the ideas really in your head. Yeah.
Did you ever live on campus?
Actually, I did. And I did a foundation year. So during my foundation year, I lived on campus, Parkwood. Campus is actually, it's quite big. Well, at first, when you just get to campus, it's massive. You get around. They put new indications up around, especially in Elliot, Rutherford. It's not quite hard now. Campus is nice. You got all your friends there. You live in next to everyone. It's secured as well. You got campus securities on 24/7. You can actually. Oh, okay. I think Dr. Arthur, there's a question for you.
Yes. So. Yes, that is called emission. We looked at, so we have absorption and we have emission. So when the light is going in, we absorb a wavelength and that is called absorption. And when the electron is falling back, it's exactly what you say, it's going to give away energy because it's going back from an excited state into a ground state. And that energy would also correspond to the same energy difference between the LUMO and the HOMO. And that energy that is emitted, that is what is the photon that I showed before. That is what normally we measure them as a particle, and it's a photon. We can measure them as wavelengths as well, but it's actually the same energy if it is going between the same energy levels. But we can, of course, excite something further up to a higher energy level. And then it is falling back between all of these. And then we measure the photon or the wavelength of the color when it is falling back from the LUMO to the HOMO. But remember, not all transitions is allowed. It's just some transitions that is allowed. So we can only change quantum numbers normally between plus or minus one, but it's called emission. It's the same actually when you are looking at, for example, X-ray what we're doing there is that we are not emitting the this electrons in the HOMER, in the valence electrons, but we are emitting the core electrons, our electrons in the K shell, if you remember, or 1s electrons. So we are ejecting those ones, and then the electron from the L shell or the 2s2p electrons are falling back. And it's that emission that we are measuring when we are doing x-rays. So that is called fluorescence, or emissions, that is fluorescence. So we can measure that as well. We have different equipment. So we have atomic absorption spectroscopy, where we measure the absorption. We also do a lot of experiments on big national facilities where we are measuring the absorption. And then we can measure the fluorescence or the emission as well. But actually, that is one of the few ways we can measure oxidation state. So if iron is ion 2 plus or ion 3 plus, for example. Any more questions? No. So let's say then, if you live on campus, Parkwood, then you can cook your own food.
Yeah.
Can you do that everywhere?
No, this so how it works, there's actually some accommodation. Don't remember the name now exactly, but they're catered. So you get your, I guess, breakfast as well, I'm not sure, but definitely lunch and dinner.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And you do still have a little kitchen. But yeah, mainly they all feed you. There's actually shops on campus where you can buy food. There's so many takeaways, restaurants. There's the library, there's the gym, there's supermarkets. There's really anything you need. You don't really need to leave campus unless you need to go to town or do like a big shopping. The price has definitely gone down. When I was on campus, it's quite expensive, but now it's definitely cheaper. So you don't really need to leave campus anymore. Yeah, but it's quite nice to live on campus. You really do have everything there. You got the study hub. They recently just made a last year, I believe, a new study hub just for science students, physical science students. So that was very helpful, because the library gets so packed. It's crazy. Everyone is always in the library, and it's quite hard to find a space to study. So the study hub really has helped for the year that was up, that we could use it. Yeah, the library as well is massive. There's books everywhere. You've got a chill out room where there's some pillows, then some blankets where you can just relax and you need. Yeah, it's really just very equipped, I would say. Yeah.
There is the cinema as well on campus.
Yeah, yeah. The cinema. Yeah.
And so yeah, and then so there is also a student support and well-being team.
They're extremely helpful. They're there all the time. You can just go and talk to anyone. They will look after you. I've actually used them a couple of times, especially for time management and CV writing, anything. They were really just there for anything you need at all. You got a nurse on campus as well. You can just see anytime. Yeah, everyone is really just there to help you succeed. You also do get an academic advisor, which is just there if you need any help throughout your lectures, anything going, if you're going through anything, you can just talk to them. They'll do your, what's it called? How can I forget the word? If you need, not a cover letter.
A reference letter.
A reference, yeah, that's it. They will do your reference if you need one. They're really just there to help you. Same as the lectures, really. You can just email them anytime. They will just be there for you. Really anytime. They will reply at night, they'll reply in the morning. Yeah, everyone just always there to help. You can't really complain. You also have
campus security. They can drive around campus. I've actually used them quite a long time because when I stay in the library too late, let's say maybe it's 3 a.m., it's dark outside, maybe you're scared, you don't want to walk alone, you can just call them, they'll take you home. They'll escort you wherever you want. They're always there, anything. Of course, then throughout all the parties, that's the only one downside. But other than that.
Especially now.
Yeah, especially now. Oh my God. Especially now. But everyone is always there to help you.
So what did you think about? I think that what you see, because you did foundation year and then you did year one. So I guess that foundation year was like an entrance into the world of university. And then stage one might be a little bit easier because you are used to being at university. But then stage two, yeah. I think it's getting a little bit more work. And then year three now, it's all getting to the end. But when you came to university foundation year and year one, did you find that it was was a higher level than from A level, or did you get into the rhythm and the studies quite easily?
Right. For foundation year, I felt like it was more like A level. It was more spoon feed to us. It was really, I don't want to say relaxed, but easier compared to stage one, where you really, there was a jump, of course, but as I was already used to university life, it wasn't that big. And it was me and my friends together, so we all tackled it together. But yeah, stage one, you do feel the difference a little bit from A level to university. At first, you feel like you're free, but it's a catch. Don't just let go of everything. Don't think that you should not revise because it's not that much work, because it will catch up all at the end when all the deadlines usually come at once. But they do give you about a month or two to do them throughout the term. You just have to learn not to leave them behind. It's not like, I don't want to say it's not like teachers say in A levels where they just lectures just abandon you. They're actually there for you. You can email them. They do have the forum on Moodle, which is where we get all of timetable lectures, all our material. We can actually ask questions anonymously. So anyone will get back to you. So you don't feel like everyone will just abandon you. It will just be you. They're still there to help you, but there is a jump. You will learn new things that you thought you never did before. We actually do a computing module in first year, and oh my God. I was so bad, but I made it, especially because of the help of lectures. Although, oh my God, I don't think I would have passed that without the help, but they are there. You will do things that are different, things that you never done before, but you will get through it. It might seem a lot sometimes. Chemistry is a very broad course. There's so much to chemistry, but don't feel discouraged. Everyone is there. Yeah, but it's nice, you know, you get to learn so much about so many different things, how you could use them. It's really eye-opening. It's honestly amazing. Then the jump from first year to second year, that is very big. Everyone always say it is. The workload is stressful, but if you do follow lecture in first year, do the work nicely, you can just carry that on into second year, and you should be already be in the rhythm on how to do the work, so it shouldn't be too much. But the jump is there, you will feel it. And then now that I'm in third year, it's only been first term, I can say it's more relaxed than second year, definitely more chilled, but the work is still there. Of course, you got your projects and you know, working with applications for jobs and everything else. So there's a lot of other things going as well, but just don't feel discouraged. You can do it, everyone is there to help you. And it's an amazing opportunity to learn so much about one subject.
And actually, just so you know, that we lecturers, we want you to make it and we want you to achieve what you can.
They will push you as well. They will be there for you, trust me. I can guarantee that.
So, and then I'm just going to ask one last question. I think, do you think there is a lot of jobs for a chemist then?
Yeah, there's actually so many. the range is unbelievable. You can really just go into anything. You can go into teaching, you can go into research, you can go into accounting, you can go into banking, you can go really into anything. Like right now, currently, I'm into an internship in consulting, not because I don't want to do chemistry, just to open more doors, just in case. You never know what's going to happen. But that's just to show that you can really get into anything if you do chemistry. You really do have so many open doors. You don't, yeah. And you learn so many, many skills, It's unbelievable. And that's what the employers value mainly, not really your knowledge behind what you do, but the skills that you learn during your degree.
Actually, I didn't have that picture here. I should probably have had it. I made a slide about famous people that had a chemistry degree. And the current, so Margaret Thatcher, she had a degree in chemistry. The COE for Pepsi, she has a degree in chemistry. Dolph Lundgren, which you don't know who it is, but he was playing in Rocky. It's a Swede, and I'm Swedish. He had not only one degree in chemistry, he had actually three degrees in chemistry, different levels from different university. And actually, I also know that the Pope, the current Pope from Argentina, he actually has a degree in chemistry as well. So you can... Wow. You can actually get a lot of different jobs. Ah, yes, and Angela Merkel. I completely forgot Angela Merkel.
Oh, really?
She has a degree in chemistry. Yeah. Actually, computational chemistry.
Oh, wow.
Her husband works in exactly the same field as I am doing. So her husband is, she is a computational chemist. So you see, computational chemist, then you can become the Chancellor of Germany. So you see, chemistry can take you in many different directions. So you can do chemistry, you can do research, you can do teaching, you can work in university, you can, but also banking, for example, and accounting. There is a lot of our students going into banking and accounting as well, and counseling.
Consulting.
Yeah, that was difficult to say this year.
No, there's so much. There's really so much you can do with it. Something to consider.
I don't know if you don't have any questions. If you have questions, you're more than welcome to contact us this after. The lecture will be recorded, so there are contact details either to us directly if you have questions about the lecture, and you can ask them anonymous in the lectures. Unfortunately, we can't do that on Zoom. But the response that you have been given in the forms, that was actually anonymous. So in the form that we used to look at the notes, that was anonymous. If there is no more questions, I would say thank you everybody for joining, and thank you Stefania for joining, and another lecture I believe on Thursday, so that one you can also log into and see another topic. Yes, thank you
everyone. Thank you.
Really nice meeting all of you, and hope to see you in Kent.